I came from Brazil. I'm originally from Brazil, and I came to the U.S. at the age of 17 to pursue my college medical school, and I went to GW Medical School in Washington, D.C. I did my residency in internal medicine at Cornell, and then I went to the NIH and Johns Hopkins for combined fellowships in critical care and infectious diseases. When I was at Johns Hopkins, I met Tom Inglesby, who was working there with me at the time at Johns Hopkins Hospital, and that's how I got involved in the field of biodefense prior to September 11th. And of course, the rest is history. I worked very closely with Tom, with Tara, with Dee Henderson, especially in the aftermath of September 11th. I spent some time at HHS advising on the biodefense programs. And most recently, in 2008, I joined the FDA to work on vaccines initially, emerging infections, as well as biological threats, and later during the H1N1 influenza pandemic, I joined the Office of the Commissioner to help respond to the pandemic, and then in my current role as leading the Countermeasures Initiative. I work at the FDA, and I direct the Office of Counterterrorism and Emerging Threats. And the Office of Counterterrorism and Emerging Threats, or OSET, is in the Office of the Commissioner. And this is the office that leads and provides oversight and management for the Medical Countermeasures Initiative, which was launched in August of 2010 in response to a year-long review of the medical countermeasures enterprise. The main goal of the MCMI is to speed development of countermeasures and increase the success rates to approval. We work very closely with the three medical product development centers at FDA, CDER, Center for Drugs, CBER, Center for Biologics, as well as CDRH, Center for Devices and Radiologic Health, to really facilitate the development of the medical products that are coming to be reviewed at these three medical product centers. Just recently, we approved levofloxacin for treatment of plague. And that's been a tremendous success story because it really relied on a government effort that has been going on for the last decade or so, as well as the private sector, to develop the animal models and the data package that allowed FDA to approve this product for plague. So this is an approval that was done under the animal rule, which is also, there only have been very few approvals done under the animal rule. So that, I think, represents a major success story. Another area that I feel very good about is FDA's engagement in the to facilitate the development and availability of multiplex diagnostic tests. These are tests that are very powerful because they can detect sometimes hundreds of pathogens. They have that capability, but the regulatory pathway was not readily available when we launched this. And through a lot of interactions with our colleagues in government, as well as obtaining scientific input from the outside, FDA now has not only developed a pathway for development of these products, but is also working very closely with colleagues outside of government to establish a reference database that would streamline the development of these products by anybody seeking to develop these products. So basically, FDA in this instance is working outside its core mission space of review, but really providing technical assistance and scientific expertise to colleagues outside of FDA. And not in the review area, but in the science and policy area, we held a first-of-a-kind symposium at FDA in regulatory science that attracted over 400 scientists just this spring. And it was really a venue for tremendous collaboration among people who are working in this area and to promote the field of regulatory science, because we know that without that, you'll be the development of countermeasures won't be as efficient as one would like. And in the area of regulatory policy, just recently we made recommendations for some changes that were incorporated in the Pandemic and Health Hazard Preparedness Act reauthorization, which is still pending with Congress. But the recommendations that we made could really make a very big difference and preparing and responding for public health emergencies. Namely, we would like to be able to agree to the use of a product in the event of an emergency before the emergency actually happens. So that provides more clarity to those who are not only stockpiling but also planning to use those products. They know what FDA is thinking ahead of time, and that's really important. One of the success stories that I'm particularly proud of is our work to improve access of life-saving therapies to the warfighter. And that was accomplished through a very interactive and engaged review that FDA did with Department of Defense request. So I feel very good about that. And I'd like to be able to continue to support the warfighter under this initiative. One area that we focus on in the regulatory science program at FDA is the tools to evaluate efficacy of products. And today we rely heavily on animal models, because and the animal rule is a tool that we can allows us to rely on animal models. But you know, even if you develop the perfect animal model, it will still be relatively imperfect. And for example, it's really very difficult to use animals to study certain products that the animal receptor in the animal is fairly different from the receptor in the human being. In addition, metabolism is another area that is very different. So as much as we like to rely on the animal models, and we must rely on them to develop products, we know that there's a whole new area of science that is emerging that we must tap its potential to make these products materialize. And one area are the biomimetic models or organ on a chip. And we have another success story is we have a very close collaboration with DARPA, the Defense Advanced Research Programs Agency. They are they have a program on biomimetic models, and FDA has been at their side in reviewing the proposals and helping select the performers, and we are providing a great deal of technical assistance because we know that there's great promise there. And if we ignore this great potential, we will be, you know, the world will be working on these biomimetic models, and FDA will still be expecting an animal model to review these countermeasures, and we don't think that's acceptable. I think the biggest challenge we have today is we need to maintain the focus on the regulatory science and focus on resources to conduct regulatory science, because the science, we have to appreciate that the science is still fairly nascent. And I worry that if we don't pay particular attention to the science of developing and approving and regulating products, they will continue to stall as they had before. And I think that for the products that are fairly mature, we are now in a more comfortable place, but there's such exciting technologies and products that are still very immature in the pipeline, and they truly require a commitment by the government to foster the development. So I think the biggest challenge, I think, is truly the lack of focus and resources to regulatory science in this budget environment.